Though Minnesota is known for its thousands of lakes, Minnesota is also rich in another resource, groundwater. For 3 out of 4 Minnesotans, groundwater is the source for water that we use for drinking, cooking, cleaning, and hundreds of other everyday household uses. Groundwater is a major source of water for cities, schools, factories, and farmers in Minnesota. As important as water is to our health, environment, and economy, most people don't understand where groundwater comes from. This video is about the Mount Simon Aquifer, a large bedrock aquifer located hundreds of feet underground that supplies water for over 1 million Minnesotans in and around the Twin Cities metropolitan area. Like other natural resources, the Mount Simon bedrock aquifer has its limits. Its supply of groundwater depends on the water that enters the ground at the surface as rainwater or melting snow that gradually seeps downward into the aquifers. The Minnesota Department of Natural Resources monitors groundwater levels in the Mount Simon and other aquifers. Groundwater data collected by state and federal hydrologists show that groundwater levels in the Mount Simon aquifer have declined over time. Other data show that there are important areas north of the Twin Cities metropolitan area that allow water to infiltrate the ground and replenish the water in the Mount Simon aquifer. The DNR has the responsibility to establish groundwater pumping limits, if needed, to protect groundwater resources. Data collected from monitoring can be used by local governments and communities to help conserve and protect their groundwater resources. We may hear the word aquifer and figure it has something to do with water, but we may not know exactly what an aquifer is or how it works. Aquifers are geologic layers made up of porous materials that, like a sponge, have spaces that can fill with enough water to serve as a water supply. An aquifer can be 2 feet or hundreds of feet beneath your feet, depending on the arrangement of underground geologic layers in the place where you're standing. In a jar full of pebbles, there are spaces between the pebbles. A lot of water can fill these spaces. Likewise, in an aquifer made of sandstone, there are spaces between grains of sand that allow water to flow through. Different types of rocks have cracks and fractures that also act as pathways for water to collect and pass through. Underground, sandy materials allow water to pass through more quickly than clay materials would. Bedrock layers commonly have cracks and fractures that also act as pathways for water to collect and pass through. How readily water passes through different materials helps hydrogeologists and well drillers determine which aquifers are better for water supply purposes. As water moves slowly downward, the aquifers are recharged or refilled over time. However, the slow refilling of aquifers also makes groundwater a limited resource because aquifers can be depleted when too much water is pumped out too quickly before the aquifers can be refilled. The groundwater we drink and use every day comes from aquifers. The water in aquifers is pumped by hundreds of thousands of wells that are located across Minnesota. Knowing that groundwater comes from surface water is important because it helps us understand how we can protect aquifers from pollution. The things we do at the surface can affect water resources deep in the ground. Aquifers can become contaminated when polluted surface soils or surface water carry pollutants with them down into the aquifer. Garbage landfills, leaking fuel storage tanks, chemicals dumped on the land surface, failing septic tanks, and fertilizer runoff from agricultural lands are some examples of contamination sources that have polluted groundwater in some Minnesota communities. When communities understand their local hydrology or how water flows across and into the land where they live, they're better able to manage and monitor surface activities that may impact their groundwater. We can't do a good job of protecting and managing our groundwater if we don't understand how it's replenished, how it moves, and how we're using it. Hi, I'm Jim Berg. I'm a hydrogeologist with the Minnesota Department of Natural Resources. I've worked on a study that was funded by the Legislative Citizen Commission on Minnesota Resources, using money from the Minnesota Environment and Natural Resources Trust Fund. This study was designed to learn important details about the physical characteristics and the groundwater recharge of the Mount Simon Aquifer. This aquifer underlies most of southeastern Minnesota, including the 11-county Twin Cities metropolitan area. The Mount Simon Aquifer provides water for more than 1 million people. The study was done between 2008 and 2012, and I'd like to briefly summarize the work we did and what we learned. To conduct these studies of the Mount Simon Aquifer hundreds of feet underground, we looked at the characteristics of the aquifer in three different ways. We installed observation wells like this one, we measured the water levels in them, and we tested the chemistry of the groundwater. 44 observation wells were installed to depths ranging from 70 to 700 feet along the western edge of the Mount Simon Aquifer, where it is closer to the surface. During the drilling, DNR and Minnesota Geological Survey geologists examined and logged the geologic layers that were penetrated. These new data were combined with records from existing wells to map the location and depths of the Mount Simon Aquifer and layers that lie above the Mount Simon Aquifer. Water level readings from these wells were combined with measurements from hundreds of other wells to create a picture of the Mount Simon Aquifer's water levels throughout the 11-county area. Studying water levels is important because it enables us to create a picture of how water usage is affecting the available groundwater supply. Because groundwater moves slowly, these water levels are lowered when wells are pumping water out of the aquifer faster than it's being replaced. Water becomes groundwater the moment it enters the land surface. The amount of time that water has been underground is called the residence time. Being able to estimate how long water has been underground lets me estimate how fast water seeps into aquifer materials. Two isotopes, tritium and carbon-14, were used in this study to estimate the residence time of groundwater. These isotopes are different forms of hydrogen and carbon that decay at predictable rates. Tritium levels are used to measure groundwater residence time up to 60 years ago, and carbon-14 lets us measure groundwater residence times from 100 to 40,000 years ago. When these isotope tests show a short residence time, it means the groundwater either travels a short path or moves quickly to recharge the aquifer. When a long residence time is shown, it means that groundwater has traveled a long path or has moved slowly. Learning the residence time of groundwater is one way that scientists determine the rate water seeps down into or recharges an aquifer. It can also tell us how quickly pollution can seep into the aquifer. The estimates of how long water has been residing in the aquifer can give us a meaningful way to compare how fast we're using water and how quickly it's being replenished in the aquifer.